After last week's episode finally brought us back to Anjiro, where Blackthorn is forced to train the Japanese in Western-style warfare, we saw how his story was significantly changed from what happens in the book, in both good and bad ways. Yet, now we have reached episode 5, the midpoint of the series. How will the story progress now under these new alterations, as Torunaga and another significant character arrive back in Anjiro to see what progress Blackthorn has had? Let us dive in and find out. And remember, there will be spoilers ahead. Episode 5 is titled Broken to the Fist. This episode does not have much going on in terms of massively moving the plot forward, but that is not to say there is not a tremendous amount of character development and interaction that takes place. The episode centers on the arrival of Torunaga, who has returned to Anjiro after we briefly parted ways with him in the previous episode. It honestly didn't seem like he was gone for that long, and I feel like had he been absent for at least another whole episode, it would have really stressed the amount of time that Blackthorn resides in Anjiro, which, as I noted previously, feels very rushed. This episode is mostly concerned with tying up the loose ends from the Anjiro arc, as Torunaga's arrival signals the conclusion of this part of the story, as from here on out we are likely going to move away from Anjiro as the war starts to heat up. So, Torunaga is back, and for some reason is just seen to be camped out with his army. We see him constantly out in the cold, and I wonder why he was not given proper housing. He is literally the most important figure in the entire region, but we are making him stay in a tent? I imagine his real housing is just not shown in the episode, but it did feel odd. Torunaga is immediately shown to be pissed off over the death of Nibara Jozen, who his son killed. He uses the phrase of being broken to another man's fist like a hawk when describing how he thinks his son Nagakado's actions in the prior episode were heavily influenced by either Yabu or Omi. Which, as a side note, I do like how Torunaga comments on the intelligence of Omi. I like this because it shows how Torunaga can see who really has the brains in the Kashigi family. But going back, just a refresher, it was Nagakado who murdered Nibara Jozen in the prior episode, after Jozen had arrived in Anjiro from Osaka to recall Yabu to swear loyalty to the council, only to then insult Nagakado and cause Nagakado to kill him. Yet later we see that Torunaga is secretly greatly pleased with what his son did, as he believes it will force the council to set out from Osaka and attack him, instead of him having to take the fight to Osaka, which would be a much more difficult task. So at least right now, it does seem like they are going to be taking the path that Jozen's death is the real catalyst for the war. In the previous review I did, I explained how I didn't think that this would be enough to cause the war based on the nature of how samurai often sought revenge, and how, almost in every case, revenge killing was considered a justifiable thing. I just want to explain this point a bit further with historical context, because some people didn't seem to understand what I was trying to get at when I discussed this in the prior video. If a samurai's character, reputation, family, or to put it simply, honor, was insulted, harmed, or disrespected in some way, samurai often saw it as a noble thing to go and seek vengeance for it, and this was something we've seen was respected by others, including their lords. I made a video about an interesting story in which a lower-ranking samurai killed a guest in his lord's home because he discovered that that individual had been the man who had killed his father decades prior. Yet after this killing, the samurai was honored for having taken his revenge, instead of being punished for breaking the sanctity of his lord's household by killing a guest. Another more famous example is that of the 47 Ronin, the Akko incident, where those samurai took revenge on a cruel individual who had caused the death of their own lord. Then later, after the deed was done, the shogun, upon understanding their point of view, had enough respect for them that he allowed them all to die with dignity through seppuku, as opposed to being tortured and executed like criminals. We had repeatedly seen how Jozen was being blatantly insulting to Nagakado. His death was nothing out of the ordinary. However, it seems like here they are not going to be taking this fact into account and instead are just going to be using the death of this glorified messenger as a pretext for armed conflict. I don't personally agree with this course of action, but I guess it is convenient for the show writers, although I would have rather the war started through something more directly done by either Torunaga or Ishido. But moving on, another character who makes his return is Buntaro, who, yes, did not actually die during the escape from Osaka. I said it back in episode 3, but I am really enjoying this portrayal of Buntaro. He comes off as a mean and angry man, and not without reason, as we may come to discover. Although in the book it is discussed how he does deeply love Mariko, he also despises her and the family she came from. Not to also mention the fact that she has also continually denied him any love and affection, simply because he has forbidden her from ever taking any action for the death of her family. The dinner scene between him, Mariko, Blackthorn, and Fujiko is great drama, as Buntoro and Blackthorn begin to challenge each other. However, there were a couple of odd things about this dinner that stood out to me. Now, it is a popular myth that people in pre-modern Japan did not eat meat. They actually did, but to my knowledge, it was usually something reserved for more significant individuals who owned the land where the animal was killed or could afford to buy it. Thus, most common people tended to simply not be able to eat meat. This does not mean, though, that they didn't, couldn't, or would find it repulsive by any means. However, for the sake of this story, they all find eating meat to be disgusting, and go so far as to refuse Blackthorn's cooking. This is massively rude. Blackthorn is a Hatamoto and head of this household. He has specifically and personally prepared a dish for you, which he was very proud to make, and upon sitting down to dinner, you refuse it? I really don't think there would have been any way they could refuse. They would have all had to have taken it. Of course, this does not mean that they had to necessarily eat it, but at least should have shown respect by taking the dish. This part just felt all sorts of disrespectful. Another odd moment was when Buntoro refused to discuss his escape, because for some reason samurai don't like to boast about their battles, I guess? What? From what I've seen and read, samurai boasted about their accomplishments just as much as anyone else. I mean, they had entire head viewing ceremonies just to show off the heads of warriors they slayed so that they could receive rewards. I don't understand such a silly idea that Buntoro does not want to discuss his escape because samurai, or maybe more broadly all Japanese people, don't like to boast? I'd like to know where they got that idea from. Unless the show is changing details about Buntaro's character and having him keep a secret about his actual escape or something like that. But anyways, Buntoro also continually calls Blackthorn a monkey, which is an interesting turnaround being that in the book most Portuguese refer to the Japanese as monkeys, something which Mariko actually calls Rodriguez on. They eventually proceed to have their drinking contest, and I love all of Fujiko's funny reactions to what is happening. It all comes to a close with the arrow scene, which is an important moment in both the book and prior adaptation, where Buntaro, to display his martial prowess, releases several arrows through the wall and out to an unseen post outside. I like that in this version, Mariko stays seated almost right in the arrow's path, not only showing her confidence in Buntaro's skill, but also then leading to Blackthorn voicing how he thinks husbands should show greater respect to their wives. This creates more tension between the two men, as Mariko is the love interest for both of them. Later, of course, Buntaro has his private outburst with Mariko where he beats her before storming off. Blackthorn then goes after him, and is surprised when Buntaro bows and apologizes for ruining the harmony of his household. This all pretty much is the same from the book. However, what is different is the aftermath of it. Blackthorn and Mariko go on to have this conversation where once again she gets into the concept of the Eightfold Fence and hiding things. She also discusses how the swords Blackthorn received from Fujiko are actually worthless and cheaply bought. Which is sad to hear, because I personally feel that it ruins the impact of not only Blackthorn receiving them, but also later when he gives them to Toranaga after the earthquake. Mariko then tells Blackthorn that they are not going to speak anymore, which is completely strange being that she is supposed to be helping him learn the language, right? I don't know, I think they just keep dropping the ball with Mariko. I don't feel anything for her character, and this refusal to speak with him anymore just seems like an odd choice to make, when many of us as the audience are still trying to figure out if we even like her character in this adaptation. In the book, she never refuses to speak with him, and in fact, the simple notion that Blackthorn shows care for her after she is beaten is something which helps to build their bond. Speaking of bonds, we are also sort of denied more of a bonding moment between Blackthorn and Fujiko after the earthquake as well. There is a bit of a brief moment between the two of them, but it's not much. I wish it was more like the book because it is a great moment where Fujiko comes to see how caring Blackthorn can really be, and helps her to start to like him more. I just hope that we do eventually get this in the coming episodes. And of course, we have to talk about the death of the gardener. I actually did feel like this was handled mostly pretty well. I like how deeply saddened Blackthorn is shown to be with this, being that it was all his fault for ordering no one to touch the pheasant under penalty of death. I just wish we would have gotten at least one more scene between Blackthorn and the gardener to really build up their friendship a little more. But I also do like how the gardener's death is a great way for Mura to hide the fact that he is the spy, by instead passing the gardener off as the spy. It's just a great way to cover up the fact that there is still a spy in the village, and something I don't think was actually in the book. Alright, so all in all, like I said at the start, this episode felt like it was just continuing to tie up loose ends, and I have to say that so far I think this is my least favorite episode. Not only do I feel that the writing is at its worst here, but it is also suffering from previous choices as well, the big one once again being that Blackthorn never had his seppuku attempt. He never had that moment where everything changed for his outlook, and I feel that it's this decision that might continue to plague the series for its remainder, if they don't at least find another way to significantly develop his character. In this episode, they even had Blackthorn flat out ask Torunaga if he and his men could just leave. I don't think at any point this happens in the book. Blackthorn asking to leave is always tied to him building up better relations between Japan and England, and returning to Japan at some point with more goods and warships. He never asks Torunaga if he can just straight up be done with Japan and leave. In fact, it's because of his change of heart initially brought upon by his seppuku attempt that we start to see Blackthorn really question if he even wants to leave Japan at all. Not to mention the fact that he also is deeply in love with Mariko by that point, which is not the case for this show. So, now that we are halfway through the series, I think it's important to address that I'm having trouble with every major character so far. Sure, I like the way that the actor is playing Blackthorn, but as far as his character goes, as well as Mariko and Torunaga, I'm not really interested in any of them. And I feel like we are going to soon be reaching a point of no return, where I don't think there'll be a good chance anymore to actually redeem any of these characters. But we'll just have to wait and see how it continues to play out. With that said though, I know I probably sound like I'm being a bit too harsh on the show, but I just expected better. However, what do you guys think? Being that we have reached the midpoint of the series, is the show progressing well for you, or do you also have concerns? Let me know in the comments below. And with that said, thank you for watching, and don't forget to like, subscribe, and ring that notification bell if you enjoyed this video and found it to be most interesting.